Welcome back to Lecture 4. The central dogma of molecular biology describes how information encoded in DNA, which can self-replicate, flows first to RNA and then to protein. Although we now know of some unusual extra routes, the key point for us here is that information encoded on a linear DNA sequence is translated into RNA and then a linear protein sequence. DNA just needs to store information. But proteins are the workhorses of the cell and do hundreds of different things for which a great variety of chemistry is necessary. Proteins are therefore composed not of 4, but 20 different building blocks. Understanding these building blocks, the amino acids, is the main topic of this lecture. But let's first look at the different roles that proteins have in a cell. A large group of proteins is responsible for doing the chemistry in the cell, the enzymes. Catalase, for example, breaks down hydrogen peroxide. Other proteins specialize in carrying specific other molecules like lipids or oxygen in the case of hemoglobin. Transport of molecules across membranes is enabled by protein channels, pumps, and pores such as the aquaporins. The internal structure, shape, and support of cells is organized by structural proteins including actin and tubulin of the cytoskeleton or collagen in connective tissue. All active movement in the cell is done by motor proteins, mainly myosin, kinesin, and dynein, as we see here in cilia. The control of gene expression is also in the hand of proteins, including the large protein class of transcription factors. Many hormones and practically all hormone receptors are proteins as well, and of course it is proteins again that relay and amplify hormones and other signals in the cell. Finally, many proteins have a specialized function in defense, such as antibodies, or the antimicrobial defensin peptides, which bind to lipid membranes and form pores in them. Many toxins, for example that of bees, work in the same way. Finally, some of Mother Nature's finest glues are proteins, including fibrinogen in blood clotting, spider silk, and muscle byssus. To perform all those incredibly varied functions, we need a sufficiently large repertoire of building blocks. Proteins are synthesized from 20 different amino acids. We're going to look at a number of their properties: the basic structure, the chirality or stereochemistry, the acid-base chemistry, and individual properties of each one amino acid. We're then going to look at how these amino acids are joined up into polypeptide chains. All amino acids that are incorporated into proteins have this basic structure. All have an amino group, a carboxyl group, and one of 20 different side chains that vary from just a hydrogen atom to quite large structures, as we will see. The central carbon atom also has one hydrogen covalently bound. This type of amino acids is called alpha amino acids, and the carbon atom that carries both the carboxyl group and the amino group, the alpha carbon atom. This is based on an old-fashioned numbering system where a chain of carbon atoms linked to a carboxyl group is labeled alpha, beta, and so on. This nomenclature has persisted in biochemistry, and you will come across it in the alpha-keto acids, such as alpha-ketoglutarate. Under the normal pH conditions of the cell, amino acids carry both a positive and a negative charge. Since the olden days of organic chemistry, this feature is called Zwitter ion, from a German word that does not mean twin, as some textbooks say, but hermaphrodite. The titration curve of an amino acid shows the two pK values of the ionizable groups. At very low pH, the amino acid is fully protonated. Moving up to pH 2 to 2.6, we reach the pK value of the alpha carboxyl group, which is now about 50% ionized. As we approach neutral pH, which is the natural environment of the cytoplasm, both carboxyl group and amino groups are ionized, and we have a Zwitter ion. At around pH 9 or 10, the amino group begins to lose its proton and is only 50% ionized at the pK of the amino group. The alpha carboxyl groups of free amino acids are all relatively strong acids and have pK values of between 1.8 and 2.6. Similarly, the pK values of the alpha amino groups are all between 9 and 10.5. However, it is important to remember that these are no longer free carboxyl or amino groups when the amino acid is part of a protein chain. All but one of the amino acids have an important property that comes from the fact that the C-alpha carbon atom has covalent bonds to four different groups. Whenever that is the case, there are two possible ways of arranging them that are mirror images of each other. There is no way to convert one into the other just by rotating bonds or by rotating the whole molecule. We say the C-alpha carbon atom and the whole molecule is chiral, from the Greek word for hand, because it gives the molecule a handedness, as in left-hand and right-hand version. Alternatively, we call it asymmetric. Amino acids are theoretically possible in two different configurations, which are mirror images of each other. Two molecules that have all the same connections of atoms but differ in their 3D arrangement are called stereoisomers. If these stereoisomers are exact mirror images of each other, as these two molecules are, we call them enantiomers. Stereoisomers are not enantiomers if there is more than one asymmetric carbon atom. In that case, different configurations are possible separately at each of them, so not all of the possible isomers will be mirror images of each other. That is actually the situation with sugars, as we are going to see later. There is a naming convention, more or less an arbitrary choice, according to which this isomer is called the L-isomer and this one the D-isomer, based on the Latin words for left and right. If you synthesize these amino acids in the lab, you get an exactly one-to-one mixture of the two enantiomers. However, for reasons that nobody has found a satisfactory explanation for, only L amino acids are incorporated into proteins. D amino acids are not rare in nature, but we don't understand their functions well. Where they are part of a peptide, such as in some bacterial cell walls, those peptides are not synthesized in ribosomes like all other proteins. The only amino acid that does not come in two enantiomeric forms is glycine. Because of the two bound hydrogen atoms, its C-alpha is not chiral. To indicate in a more systematic way which configuration the residues have, we sometimes use the Fischer projection. Imagine the carboxyl group and the side chain pointing vertically out of the plane of the screen or paper. The amino groups and the hydrogen atom then point towards us. In this orientation, L amino acids have the amino group pointing left, and D amino acids have it pointing right. Not by coincidence, actually, that's how the nomenclature came about. This projection is then flattened like this to give the Fischer projection. It is important to remember that this representation with the vertical and horizontal bonds has a precise meaning. If we draw an amino acid like this, in the skeletal form, we do not specify the stereochemistry. This could be either an L or a D amino acid. Now we understand the properties of amino acids in general, let's look at their individual chemistry. There are a number of different ways to split the 20 amino acids into meaningful subgroups. Typically, we distinguish aliphatic, aromatic, sulfur-containing, basic and acidic amino acids and the amides of those acids. And finally, there are alcohol amino acids with hydroxyl groups. And one that doesn't fit into any category, proline. Let's start with the aliphatic amino acids. The name aliphatic is another old-fashioned chemical word for hydrocarbons, excluding aromatic compounds with a benzene ring. As we get to know the individual amino acids, let's also start to learn the one- and three-letter codes for each. It seems a drag to memorize them, but they are genuinely used all the time when protein structure or function is discussed, so it's a good investment of brain space. Glycine is the smallest amino acid and, as we have seen, the only one that's not chiral. Glycine is neither here nor there in terms of hydrophobicity, but the fact that no bulky side group is attached allows it to squeeze into tight places and narrow bends in protein structures, so it has its own unique function. The next four, alanine, valine, leucine and isoleucine, could be seen as a toolbox of amino acids with increasing hydrophobicity, with isoleucine being by far the most hydrophobic of all amino acids. We will see later that hydrophobic residues are essential for protein folding. Because of the hydrophobicity, they cluster away from water. The last three in this list, valine, leucine, and isoleucine, are called branched-chain amino acids, for obvious reasons. All of them are essential amino acids in the human diet and make up more than a third of amino acids in muscle protein. Proline is one of a kind. We can imagine its structure as an aliphatic amino acid with a three-carbon chain where the outer carbon atom forms a bond with the alpha amino group. This ring with one non-carbon atom is called a heterocycle. This particular one goes by the name of pyrrolidine. It is much less hydrophobic than the other aliphatic amino acids. Because of the ring structure, rotation around the N-C-alpha bond, which is central to the secondary structure of proteins, is restricted in proline. This has a unique effect on the conformation of the protein backbone. Proline cannot be accommodated in some types of secondary structures. The aromatic amino acids are phenylalanine, tyrosine, tryptophan, and histidine. The one thing they all have in common is that they contain ring structures, a benzene ring in the case of the first three, with alternating, we also say conjugated, double bonds, whose pi electrons are delocalized, literally all over the place. Other than this property, these four amino acids have not so much in common. Their hydrophobicity varies widely, depending on the proportion of electronegative atoms like oxygen or nitrogen to apolar hydrocarbon ring. Phenylalanine is very hydrophobic, tryptophan somewhat less so, and histidine is highly hydrophilic. Histidine is interesting because it is a weak acid. With a pK of 6.0, only a small proportion of exposed histidine residues will be protonated in the cytoplasm. Both histidine and tryptophan side groups can engage in hydrogen bonding. Another important role for histidine is in coordinating metal ions in proteins like hemoglobin. Tyrosine is a hydroxyl amino acid, as are serine and threonine. All three are polar, although serine and threonine are quite a bit more polar than tyrosine, and all hydroxyl groups engage in hydrogen bonding as donor as well as acceptor. These hydroxyl groups can also form esters with phosphoric acid. We call this protein phosphorylation, and it has a fundamental role in signaling within cells. Another unique amino acid is cysteine. It is basically the sulfur analog of serine and has some properties that are similar. For example, it is able to form hydrogen bonds, although these are weaker than those formed by hydroxyl groups. Compared with serine, cysteine is a much stronger acid. With a pK of 8.3 in water, and often less than that within a protein structure, the thiolate anion plays a role in many catalytic reactions. Finally, the ability to join cysteine thiol groups by oxidation is important for the structure of many extracellular proteins, including this one, insulin. Methionine is relatively hydrophobic, about as much as alanine. Its claim to fame is mainly that protein biosynthesis in all organisms starts with a methionine. Aspartate and glutamate are the two acidic amino acids with very similar properties. They engage in salt bridges, that is, ion-ion interactions on the surface and the interior of proteins, as well as ion-dipole interactions with water. The side chains of aspartate and glutamate are weaker acids than the alpha-carboxyl groups. The pK of both amino acids is near 4. Still, that means that any surface-exposed carboxyl groups in vivo are fully ionized as carboxylate ions. Both aspartate and glutamate also come in amide form, asparagine and glutamine. These are not acidic or basic, but they are highly polar and they're strong hydrogen bond donors as well as acceptors and are typically found on the surface of proteins. Finally, the basic amino acids. We have already met one of them, histidine. However, because of its low pK of 6, it is mostly uncharged under normal conditions. Lysine and arginine, in contrast, are very strong bases because the free electron pairs of the terminal nitrogen atoms are very good proton acceptors. Arginine is by far the strongest base because the positive charge of the protonated form, the conjugate acid, can be delocalized over the guanidino group. So wow, that's a lot to remember. You should know the general structure of amino acids, that is, know that there is an alpha carbon atom which has an amino group, a carboxyl group, a side chain and an extra hydrogen atom bound to it. You should know that the alpha carbon atom is asymmetric, and what the acid-base chemistry of amino acids and the side chains is. You don't need to be able to draw the structures from memory, but you should recognize them and remember what properties they have. And finally, the 1 and 3 letter codes of amino acids are essential knowledge.